Hello and welcome to the Didn't Works YouTube channel. I promise that's the last cheesy intro I do to any one of my videos, but there is a reason I chose the Doctor Who theme. So that was Murray Gold's interpretation of the Doctor Who theme, which was originally recorded by Delia Derbyshire in 1963. And it was a fascinating and quite scary piece of electronic music, the original. Now, the reason I've chosen Doctor Who is because it was recorded at the BBC and it's aired on the BBC, and these speakers have some heritage from the BBC. Let's have a chat about them. Okay, so these are Rogers Studio 1A, and before that was the Rogers Studio 1, and before that was the Rogers Export Monitor, and before that was the Rogers LS36, and before that, strangely, was the Spendor BC1. Now, the reason I'm mentioning this is the BBC wanted a monitor of a particular type, and quite independently of the BBC, Spencer Hughes developed the BC1, very famous loudspeaker. It was then slightly modified, and Rogers got the contract to build under license the Rogers LS36. So it is actually the BC1 first, then the LS36, which Rogers built. Then we follow this path down. So after the LS36 is the Rogers Export Monitor, and then we move into an area of sort of more domesticated loudspeakers where you've got the Rogers Studio 1. And that's about the time Rogers actually started producing properly their own bass units. The previous one had a Daylesford unit in it. So once you get to the Rogers Studio 1, you then move slightly further forward in time and you get to the Rogers Studio 1A. So the dimensions of the cabinet are very similar. They're very reminiscent of a lot of BBC style monitors from that era. But things are slightly different. You've gone away from that 8-inch bass unit, moving up to a Celestion HF1300. This is actually the GEC presence unit, where the original version of that unit, and there were various types. So obviously the BC1 used a Cole super tweeter up from the HF1300. The Rogers used either the KEF T27 or the Celestion HF2000. So there's still some very strong Celestion connections there, even though the actual overall speaker was designed and built by somebody else. Which brings me on to these. Now, although these are a Rogers speaker, it's a genuine, legitimate Rogers-built bass unit, the HF unit is actually a Celestion 1.25-inch aluminium dome tweeter, which is very, very similar to the HF unit used in the Celestion SL6S and so on. Now, my friend Ed Form was instrumental in developing that aluminium dome tweeter as an improvement over the copper dome tweeter used in the 600 and the SL6. So it's kind of difficult for me to age these exactly, but I'm figuring these must have gone into development around about 1983-84, because these HF units are actually identical, apart from the faceplates, to the Celestion DL8 Series 1, the slightly smaller magnet on the DL8, worth mentioning, the DL10, which has exactly the same size magnet, and the Celestion, very rare, Ditton 88, which also has that size magnet. So we're following a theme there that a lot of manufacturers, particularly ones who are doing BBC style loudspeakers, actually used other manufacturers' HF units, sometimes KEF, sometimes Audex, sometimes Celestion, and in this case, Celestion. Let's have a look inside them and see what they're all made of.
Right, I'm gonna have to do this sort of handheld, so excuse any shaky camera business. There's the crossover down there, and you can see the bitumen panels on the side wall, the back wall. They're all iron core inductors, and you've got reasonable material. These are all okay, I should imagine. That I would possibly consider changing. 24 UF ALCAP maybe, might be worthwhile changing that due to the age of the speakers. But in all honesty, listening to them, I haven't found that they're particularly bad in any way. So then moving away from there, that is, although these are Rogers speakers, that's actually, they've torn the label off, but that's a Celestion 1.25-inch aluminium dome tweeter. Now, if I plonk this on top, it's get those screws to just line up. That might look a little bit more familiar. That's a DL10 or Ditton 88 faceplate. So I'm pretty sure that's the same HF unit. Now the dome itself is probably the same as the SL series, Celestion SL6, SL12, so on and so on. But the magnet is much, much bigger. That's a much larger magnet than you'd find on that HF unit. So it's more powerful, better, higher efficiency. And over here is a polypropylene, Roger's own base driver. Let's spin that round. So there we go, 8 ohm unit. Pretty nice chassis. There's a slight bit of scarring on the polypropylene there, but nothing too major. So yeah, that's pretty much the inside of Roger's Studio 1A. Let's put them back together and we'll have a listen.
So in between putting these back together, I had a quick message with my friend Matt Casey from Haycross Audio, and I've got to agree with him on this, that there's probably massive room for improvement on those crossovers. There's several components that we could pull out and upgrade, but I'm going to leave them as they are for the minute, just because actually they don't sound too bad. That is how they were voiced. I wouldn't really want to play about with anything too much, but possibly in the future I might consider removing those crossovers and upgrading them. I might confer with Matt on that because he's got quite a lot of experience with Roger's loudspeakers, particularly on the crossovers. I haven't. This is the first pair of official Rogers I've ever owned. I have had Jim Rogers speakers, who is actually the founder of Rogers. I think that was in 1947 Rogers was founded. There's some very complicated and slightly dubious history about Rogers, and your best bet if you want to look up history on Rogers is check out Mark Hennessy's webpage. He has meticulously pulled apart the entire history on Rogers loudspeakers. So personally me, I had Jim Rogers JR149s, which was actually after he'd left in quite a lot of trouble the Rogers company, but these are well and truly Rogers. So probably the question on anyone's lips is, how do they sound? Well, they're very typical of, in a way, of that BBC style of cabinet. So they're very lossy, bitumen lined cabinets. They're typical dimensions of many of the sort of LS36 BC1 style loudspeakers. The Spendor SP1s are similar dimensions as well. But they do differ slightly. And let's talk about the bass first. So the bass is typical BBC style. You've got that polypropylene cone, so you've got really quite nice mid-range and a very soft, fairly deep bass, which is quite pleasant to listen to. But where these differ is that HF unit, and this is what interested me about these from the get-go, is the fact that they've got that Celestion aluminium 1.25 dome tweeter. I'm very familiar with that HF unit, or a derivative of that HF unit. And because it's quite a large unit, 1.25 inch, its dispersion pattern, its polar pattern, is very interesting. And it's quite nice to listen to. If they're set up properly in spec and, well, give a decent amplifier behind them, they don't get harsh or bright like a lot of people complain they do. They are really quite nice, very smooth. But it's the dispersion pattern that I like, that the way they image is really, really nice. They are a pleasure to listen to. So we've almost got what I really love about the SLs with that lovely HF. They haven't got the same mid-range capability of the SL. They're a smaller driver on the SL, infinite baffle speaker, so very different sounding in the mid-range. But polypropylene, very reminiscent of the sort of Spendor sound that I really like, and they've got that really quite deep, soft bass, which wouldn't be to everyone's taste, and it's certainly not particularly modern sounding. If I compare what they sound like to the Russell K's I was listening to yesterday, there's just a million miles difference in timing, pace, dynamics, so on and so forth. But with the right type of music at the right volume, if you pick your genre carefully, these are really pleasant to listen to. They're very, very warm, very musical. But the difference is they've got really, really, really nice, crystal clear, crisp detail in the HF with very nice imaging. They're not a bad pair of loudspeakers. So I'm going to chuck up a few sound clips. I'll try and find something that's a little bit better than the Doctor Who theme, because that's not particularly well recorded. So That's the Ditton Works review on the Rogers Studio 1A loudspeakers, something I've been looking for a long, long time, and I'm very pleased to have got some. With their grills, they're not in bad condition, there's no issues with the HF units. At some point, I may consider taking Matt's advice and having a look and modifying and upgrading those crossovers. But for now, I'm just going to sit back for the rest of the day and enjoy some loudspeakers that have quite a rich history starting at the BBC. Take care, guys. I'll catch up with you soon.
Don't you dream without me.